Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Magic Ambush by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Rebecca Mitchell. Chapter 1. The ground was shaking. Leaves trembled on the trees that lined the sides of the hidden valley. The stream's water frothed and lapped against the base of the crystal that sat at the center of it all. The gem-like monolith glowed with magic, as well as the bright light of a Texas dawn. Under one of the trees, Fran Berryman sat with her phone in one hand and a ball of light magic cupped in the other, just in case. She didn't expect to be part of the action, but it was always best to be on the safe side.
"You could have dressed a little more subtly," Singar said. The Willen was half Fran's height and had a rat-like face. She was sitting with her back against the tree, a laptop on her knees, and assorted sensors plugged into the computer. Some were purely technological, designed to measure infrared light, unusual sound waves, or vibrations in the ground. Others were more esoteric, crystals and runic cards attached to the ends of data cables to pull in information about any magic around them. Singar pointed at one of those crystals across the valley, calibrating it against the magic given off by one of the Evermores waiting in ambush around the crystal.
"I like these clothes."
Fran ran a hand down her sequined t-shirt and embroidered jeans.
"At least I left my roller skates at home. They wouldn't have done you much good here."
Singar nodded at the rough ground running down to the stream, then straightened her baggy camo print shirt.
"But that outfit is going to draw the target's attention the minute it appears.
It'll be fine," Fran smiled. "The source isn't interested in me. It's after the Kamana crystal, remember? Winslow told us."
"Yeah, but did you notice how he didn't tell us why?"
"I'm sure he'll tell us later."
"I think you're trusting these people too much, just because they've got the same magic as you."
"Because I'm one of them."
Fran toyed with one of the sequins.
"I know this is, like, a weird thing to say, but now I know that I'm an Evermore, that I've got these strange powers in common with them, I wanna—"
"Hold that thought,"
Singar said, as something started beeping excitedly on her computer.
"We've got trouble incoming."
Across the valley, the Evermores were bracing themselves. In their sturdy boots and worn jeans, they would have appeared to most people like another group of hikers out enjoying the wilds, not a group of centuries-old magicals bracing themselves for battle. Then again, most people wouldn't have been able to find this valley. Past a certain point, disguises didn't matter. Winslow, the leader of the Evermore group, raised his arms and started to chant. The others joined in, and as they did so, magic flowed from their hands, weaving a net in the air. It shone with power, but a subtly different sort than the Kamana crystal. The Evermore's magic lay in light and sound, and that was what they'd woven their trap from. The ground shook more violently, and the stream lapped across its banks as if the water was trying to escape. Then there was a roar, and the ground burst open to close the crystal. Dirt flew through the air, and a creature emerged, water flowing past it down into the hole. The source was a being of pure power, its constantly changing body made up of magical energy. Its legs were those of a bear one moment and a giant chicken the next. Mole-like paws the size of digger scoops became razor-sharp claws, became clusters of tentacles that waved like they were stroking the air. Its head was a lion one moment and a pointed selection of crystal shards the next, but it always looked fearsome. It stepped out of its hole and ran one of its shining limbs down the crystal. The Evermore's chanting rose in volume, and the net they'd been weaving closed in around the source. It finally noticed them and howled, a distorted, discordant noise like a tornado blowing through a trumpet shop. Fran held her phone steady, filming the source as it turned to face the Evermore's.
"Wow, That thing is, like, so weird and so amazing. It's certainly different.
Singar adjusted one of her sensors, her eyes never leaving the computer screen as she watched the data rolling in.
We need them to keep it there for a while if we're going to get enough data to redesign the trap. They might catch it. Then they won't need our containment unit. Let's hope not, for the sake of our profit line.
The Evermores closed in on the source, hands still raised. The net grew more tangled the closer they got, but Fran found it hard to make out the details. There was so much light, sound, and magic from the source and the Evermores that it all turned into a jumble. She had to keep filming. They could make sense of it later. Then something changed. Wings spread wide from the source's back, and the Evermores went flying. Strands of magical net evaporated as the whole thing burst apart. Winslow landed on his feet, as graceful and steady as a martial arts master in a kung fu movie. He charged straight back in at the source, hands waving through the air, spinning a circle of light. The source turned to face him. He flung the light at it, but whatever he'd been trying to do, it didn't work. The source absorbed the attack, then opened its mouth and spat a beam of sound so powerful that Fran saw it rippling in the air. Winslow dodged around it and grabbed hold of the source's arm. His magic flowed, shaking the source with a deep and powerful sound wave, but it flung him off. This time he splashed down on his back in the middle of the stream. Winslow's attack might not have beaten the source, but it had given the other Evermores time to recover. They were back on their feet with magic in their hands. Enfield ran over to the fallen Winslow and gave him a potion from a pouch, while the others used blasts of sound magic to push the source away from the crystal. They were moving out in a loose circle, trying to surround the source as they steered it, maneuvering toward an open patch of ground on Fran and Singar's side of the stream.
That's not going to work, Singar muttered as she stared at her screen. How can you tell?
Fran tried to glance at the readings while keeping her phone pointed toward the source, but it was hard to take in both things at once.
The power levels. These guys are potent, but they're not as coordinated as their poses pretend, and that thing's an absolute beast. No way will they overcome it.
I don't know. They're winning right now. Maybe.
The source lunged at one of the Evermores. As it moved, its body changed again, becoming a narrow, focused shape like the head of a gigantic arrow. It cut straight through the magic the group had been weaving and sliced into the shoulder of the Evermore, who yelled in pain as she fell. The source landed past her, and its shape changed again. Now it was a thing from nightmares, a hound the size of a tow truck with blazing eyes and pointed teeth. The savage claws of its six legs tore up the dirt as it ran up the slope, straight at Fran and Singar.
We have to help.
Fran dropped her phone, raised her hands, and opened her mouth wide. She yelped, and her magic added to the sound, turning it into a concussive blast that hit the source right on its snout. The source flicked its head, shaking off the pain, and kept running. Fran threw another blast of sound magic, and another. The third hit the source in its shoulder, and it started to limp. Then its legs became wheels, and it moved steadily again. Faster now, a snarling dog riding the bulbous tires of a monster truck. Fran stood her ground. She was sure that was what you were supposed to do in a fight, especially when your friends were in trouble. If the Evermores weren't quite her friends yet, they were relatives. She gathered all the power she could muster, shaking the earth in front of her, turning it from solid ground into loose dust that anything the size and weight of the source would surely sink into. Wings sprouted from the source's back again. It soared over the broken ground. Fran had a fraction of a second to stare in terrified awe as it sailed right across her trap. Then Singar slammed into her, knocking her out of the source's path.
The source flew past them and hit the ground on all four wheels. Singar had pulled a switchblade from the folds of her skin. She rammed it into the closest tire. However, it was nowhere near enough to stop the source. The knife was wrenched out of Singar's hand and flung down into the dirt as the source kept moving, rolling on up the hillside. The Evermores ran after it, hands and voices raised as they summoned their magic. Winslow was in the lead, dripping from the stream. "Weave a new net," he shouted. "Pen it before it can get away." It was too late. The source leapt into the air. Its front turned into the head of a giant drill, and it slammed into the ground. Rocks and dirt flew as it burrowed into the earth, vanishing into the darkness. Enfield ran to the edge of the hole and peered down the tunnel the source had left in its wake.
"Should we follow it?" he asked. "Try to catch it while it's wounded?"
"We wouldn't catch it," Winslow said. "We barely scratched it. Again." He picked up the switchblade and handed it to Singar.
"I'm afraid that weapons like this won't do much damage against a being of pure power."
"Maybe not, but it'll think twice about messing with me again."
Singar folded the knife and carefully wrapped it in a clear plastic bag.
"Besides, I'm mostly after the blood sample. The more data we have, the better we can adapt the containment unit ready for next time."
"I admire your diligence," Winslow smiled. "Fran has done well in recruiting staff for her company. I should warn you against assuming that the source will learn from what you just did, or that it thinks in any way. It's a beast of pure instinct, not of reason."
"Then I'll keep sticking it with knives until its instincts tell it to lay off."
Singar put the knife in her backpack, then picked up the laptop with its attached sensors.
"Oh, dung. The screen's cracked. Let's hope that was the only thing that got damaged."
Down by the stream, a pair of Evermores used sound waves to collapse the tunnel that the source had arrived from, while Enfield did the same for its escape route. The idyllic forest Kamana, a place of magical refreshment and thriving life in the middle of the desert, wasn't quite back to how it had been, but it was close enough.
"Back to your office?"
Winslow asked as he summoned a portal, a glowing ring through which they could step from Earth to Oriceran. Through it, the wall of a dusty basement was visible.
"We have some other sensors to gather first," Singar said. "We'll meet you there."
"I'll leave the portal open."
"That's okay."
Fran pulled out a handheld mirror with runes and circuitry attached to the back.
"We have ours."
She tucked it away again for safekeeping. The Evermores stepped through the portal, which closed neatly behind them. For the first time since they'd arrived that morning, the valley seemed peaceful. Singar stowed away the sensors attached to the computer, while Fran gathered others they'd set around the valley. She picked up her phone, which was dusty but intact. Then she pulled out the mirror. Before she could activate it, Singar laid a hand on Fran's forearm.
"I'm serious about what I said earlier," the Willin said. "Whatever Winslow is to you, he's not being completely honest with us. He's bad news for the company, and I'm not sure he's planning to pay us. It'll be fine."
Fran offered her friend a reassuring smile. "We're not doing this part for the money, remember?" Singar wrinkled her nose.
"I hope that wasn't supposed to sound like a good thing."
Chapter 2. In a gloom-laden world of nightmares and anguish, the darkness between dreams sat watching its creatures at play beneath a scab-red sky. The nightmare hounds chased each other across a landscape as twisted and unforgiving as the darkness between dreams' mind. It was a bleak and terrible place. That was why the darkness loved it, and why it wanted more of reality to be like this. More space for the dark and twisted. More room for the darkness's people.
Soon, the darkness said. It stroked the head of one of its hounds with a tentacle. Soon we'll break the barriers, and you can go through. Soon the earth will be ours.
The darkness sighed, a sound like the gurgling of pipes in a broken-down factory.
First, I have to gather my resources. I have to understand what we are facing.
The hound's needle-like teeth sank into the darkness's tentacle. The darkness laughed and shook off the dog. The beast flew into a circle of other nightmare creatures, and they tore at each other with teeth and claws. It was enough to make the darkness between dreams swell with pride. The darkness extended a tentacle and drew a circle in the air. Magic flowed and formed a portal. If only it were this easy to make a way through for the hounds and all the other nightmare creatures. However, the darkness needed to pave the way for them first, to make a world they could live in. For itself, the portal was enough. The darkness stepped through into a top-floor office in a tower block on Oriceran. The office was large and decorated with the quality that extraordinary wealth could buy. A vast desk of imported red hardwood and a firmly upholstered chair custom-made to fit its owner dominated the workspace. A pair of abstract paintings on the walls, both the work of critically acclaimed artists, provided splashes of color. Across the room from the desk were floor-length windows that looked out from the 20th floor across the irregular, improvised urban sprawl of Mana Valley. The portal closed. The darkness between dreams went to the back of the room and opened a wardrobe hidden in the wall. It pulled out a skin suit, a thing made with as much magical as technological skill, designed and refined by witches, beauticians, and plastic surgeons. The darkness stepped into it, its body flowing to fit the human form, and carefully closed the opening up the front. When it looked in the mirror mounted to the wardrobe door, it wasn't the darkness between dreams anymore. Instead, tech entrepreneur and Mana Valley celebrity Howard Phillips smiled back from the polished glass. Phillips selected a suit from the wide selection on the rack, all handmade to his measurements by the finest gnome tailors. He'd barely pulled his pants on when there was a knock on the office door.
"Come in, Julia."
The door opened, and Julia Lacey, his personal assistant, walked in. She blushed and averted her eyes when she saw him standing there bare-chested. One hand pushed back a strand of blonde hair that had broken loose from her ponytail.
"I'm sorry, Mr. Phillips. I can come back when you've dressed."
"Really, Julia? Do you think I'm going to get embarrassed about this?"
He slid a tentacle out through the wrist of the suit and waved it in front of his chest.
"This isn't even me naked."
Julia laughed.
"Of course not. Sorry, Mr. Phillips. It's a habit, I suppose."
"Never let habit get in the way of your work. That's not how we win in Mana Valley."
Julia sat in front of the vast desk and laid a tablet on her knee.
"Would you like to go over today's schedule?"
"I need to talk to you and Hondar first."
Phillips buttoned up his shirt, watching himself in the mirror the whole time. He liked this body, partly because it reflected the extent of his power over this place, but he could never quite get used to it. Wizards had such a strange form, with only four limbs and two eyes. That was no way to design a body. Julia's fingers tapped on her tablet. A minute later, as Phillips was doing up his tie, the door opened again. Hondar Ennis walked in. The contrast between Phillips' bodyguard and his PA was dramatic. Hondar was a towering slab of Kilomea muscle, Julia a slender, diminutive woman. Hondar was intimidatingly ugly, with his wrinkled brow and tusks, while Julia was, as others reliably informed Phillips, what humans considered quite pretty. Hondar solved his problems with muscle and intimidation,
while Julia used knowledge, magic, and more subtle forms of persuasion. That contrast was why Phillips found it valuable to have them both around. That, and their willingness to work with a nightmare beast set on conquering the world. Not everybody could get on board with that part.
"Sit down, Hondar," Phillips said. "I don't need guarding here."
The Kilomea scowled, but sat next to Julia. The seat creaked under his bulk, but didn't bend or break. Phillips bought his furniture to last. If it couldn't withstand a heavy body, what use would it be once this whole valley was a mass of blood and shadows and tentacular beasts? Fully dressed, Phillips closed the wardrobe and made his way to another wall section. A brief wave and a touch of magic opened it to reveal a safe. He entered the key code, opened the door, and took out an ancient sheet of parchment.
"The prophecy our late gnomish friend found."
He laid it carefully on the table and sat.
"Very inconsiderate of him to die before he could bring it to me, or perhaps share what else he knew about his sources." "One of the test prophecies, ain't it?" Hondar growled. "It seems that way. Like so much information around those ancient manuscripts, it's incomplete."
Julia leaned forward in her chair, far more interested in the document than Hondar was. She peered at the writing, trying to decipher an ancient text in an obscure script, written with all the cryptic evasions that made prophecy such a nightmare to untangle.
"Is there something you'd like us to do?" she asked.
"A clue to where the rest of the document is, perhaps."
"Nothing so helpful. But there's something in here I want you to pursue."
Phillips tapped a finger against a line on the manuscript. The appendage bent at an unnatural angle as the tentacle inside the skin suit briefly twisted to its usual patterns before snapping back into something more human.
"These Evermores," he said. "They're supposed to guard the magic on Earth. I want to know more about them." "You think we could seize control of Earth's magic, boss?" Hondar asked. "Make them all do your bidding in return for their power?"
"We can't leap straight to the takeover, Hondar. We have to lay some groundwork first, and I think these Evermores could be a valuable source of power in their own right."
Julia looked over some notes on her tablet. "The prophecy implies that they have powerful magic and control over an even more powerful magic source. Are you thinking that we might ally with them? Gain access to this source of power?"
Philip shook his head. "I've been dealing with magicals for millennia, and I've started to understand groups like this one. They're people with a mission, a great sense of their righteousness. They'll have some moral direction or code of honor that means they have to keep protecting the Earth. You can't successfully stay hidden this long without the certainty that brings. When they find out about me, they'll want to stop me, not to help.
So they're an obstacle to be overcome,
or an opportunity."
Phillips got up from his desk and walked over to the window. He stood there with his hands behind his back, gazing out. The other two, experienced in their employer's moods, went to stand either side of him. Beyond the window, Mana Valley sprawled in the sunshine, beaming down between the mountain lines that ran to north and south. On either side of the River Almain, tower blocks reached into the sky. Some were modern, slick fingers of concrete and glass. Others were older, the homes of ancient wizarding orders, polished buildings of marble with shining turrets and wide balconies. Others combined the two styles, tradition and modernity melding like the magic and technology for which the valley was renowned. Around them, the city sprawled for miles in every direction. There were apartment blocks, factories, warehouses, mounds full of gnome and willin tunnels. There were roads, railways, and power lines. In the foothills were the grand arches of dwarf strongholds and the scree slopes made of rubble from their mines. Vast lizards flew alongside flocks of birds, and an elf flew past on a giant butterfly, a spectacular way to stay clear of the commuter traffic.
Mana Valley is the key, Philip said. There's so much power here, applied in so many ingenious new ways. It's the point where earthly technology and Oriceran magic achieve their greatest coming together. It's a key point around which the universe turns. That makes it a weak point, too. One that we can exploit. To do that, I need power of my own. Coming here sets certain limits upon me. I'm not everything that I would be in my realm. If I can consume the power of others, unique and ancient power, then I can do what I need to do. I can crack open the walls between realities, turn this whole place into one giant portal, and use it to channel my power and my minions onto Earth.
You're going to suck the power from these Evermores? Hondar asked.
Yes. For that, I need to find them. I'm going to be working some magic of my own, but I need you two to set your minions on the task. Call back whatever hirelings or summonings you sent out to find that portal mirror and set them on this instead.
Julia and Hondar exchanged a look.
There's a problem there, boss, Hondar said. Those guys, they ain't come back.
Philip stepped back and stood facing his employees, arms folded across his chest.
What do you mean they haven't come back? Are they dead? Ran off? Arrested?
We don't know, Julia said. After the first few magic mirrors they found turned out not to be the target, we both told our people not to report back until they found the right one. Now they're not answering us. Philip stroked his chin, a human gesture he'd seen on television and found oddly satisfying.
So, somebody else is standing in the way of my plans. I wonder if they know what they're doing, or if they got lucky. Well, it doesn't matter. Find some new hirelings, summon some new spirits. Do whatever you need to do. Find me these Evermores.
Yes, sir, they chorused. Julia headed out the door, but Hondar lingered, frowning as he looked out the window once more.
Is there something else you wanted to discuss? Phillips asked. I have a meeting with the senior management team.
That mirror, Hondar said. You was going to try to get to the Netherworld, to summon an army of the dead.
Yes, I know my plans.
Ain't we doing that no more? I liked the idea of working with dead people.
Oh, it's still on my agenda.
Phillips nodded at the door, which was open a crack.
Hondar closed it. It's not a priority now, and not one that I want to push around Julia.
Why? She went along with it before.
She'll do as she's told, but I've been reviewing her human resources file. There are certain sensitivities, losses in her past. Dealing with the Netherworld might bring those up and destabilize her.
We'll pursue that avenue quietly for now, without her direct involvement. When the time comes, she can come to terms with the results. Until then, I want her in top form. No need to bring up the Netherworld around her again.
Understood?
Yes, boss.
Good. Now go find me these Evermores.
Chapter 3. Fran skated slowly along the sidewalk so her colleagues could keep up. That wasn't much of a challenge with Elith and Tannerin, whose long legs and elven stride meant that she could move quickly even in a pencil skirt. But Bart Trumbling only had a gnome's legs, and an old gnome's legs at that. Letting him keep up meant making slow progress. Elithin glanced at her watch and tutted.
We're going to be late, she said. People at this level don't appreciate being made to wait. They're all either very busy
or the sort of people who would rather be skiing than in a meeting.
You could have gone without me, Fran said. Then I could have stuck around in the workshop to look at the source data with Singar and Smokey instead of rushing straight from the portal to this.
We couldn't do this without you. You're the CEO of ManaWave Industries. Big investors need to meet you in person to evaluate you and what the company offers. The company's face is a critical part of its sales pitch.
Surely they only care about the money we could make. This is all about figures, right, Bart?
I'd like to agree with you, Bart said. It would certainly make my job easier as director of finance. The fact is, even the most modern investment funds don't work by pure, cold logic and spreadsheets. The human factor matters, and part of the human factor means showing that we're treating them seriously. That's where you come in.
Fran sighed. This wasn't what she'd expected when she decided to set up her own magitech company. It was all going to be about experiments with circuitry and spells, about making new machines that did things no one had ever done before, or did them better than anyone else could. It was going to be her in a lab, surrounded by heaps of machinery, reinventing the world. Instead, there were all these meetings and emails. So many emails that they tempted her to invent a spell code that would answer them for her.
Who is it today? She asked.
Elizabeth Dooley. Elithan opened her phone and brought up a file, reading the screen without slowing her pace. Head of Dooley Holdings. They have operations here and on Earth. They've backed most of the biggest tech innovators of the past 20 years, both magical and mundane. She's renowned for her ability to pick a winner. Get her on board, and half the hedge funds in the valley will be hammering at our door, looking for a chance to invest.
They'd better not hammer too hard. Our door has rusty hinges.
Fran had expected Dooley Holdings to be based in one of the slick modern tower blocks down by the river. Instead, their route carried them to one of the older buildings, half Wizard's Tower and half Anthill, with giant termites crawling over the outside, carrying out maintenance work. A gnome receptionist directed them to an elevator at the back of the lobby, powered by a pair of 6-foot stick insects in a giant hamster wheel. The turning wheel pulled on a rope that lifted the wooden elevator through 5 floors to the hallway outside a meeting room.
I feel like I've shrunk to the size of a fly, Fran said. Is there a giant spider somewhere that's going to catch us in its web?
Don't make any comments about this place unless Dooley asks you to, Elithan said. Her family made their fortune retraining transport and agricultural insects for construction and industry. She's very proud of that background. That's why she always invites potential investments here, so she can show off what the Dooley's made.
Got it. No spider jokes.
Fran nodded.
I will be the embodiment of seriousness.
Good. The quirky roller-skating CEO is great for grabbing headlines and getting us into the room. But once we're there, you need to show what you're capable of. Right, Bart?
Oh, absolutely.
Bart ran a comb through his tousled mess of white hair.
This is the big leagues now, and it's the funding we need to step things up at Mana Wave. With her backing, we could buy some of those new 3-dimensional printing machines that Singar's so excited about, not to mention the enchanted processors Smokey has been demanding. It would be a huge advantage for us all.
He smiled at Fran.
I know you've got this.
Thanks, Bart. Fran grinned.
All right, let's do it.
She pushed the door of the meeting room open and rolled in. The others walked in behind her. The meeting room was much more modern than the building around it. Only monitors decorated the walls, 2 of them showing figures from stock markets across 2 worlds, the rest currently blank. A meeting table stretched down the room's length with metal chairs on either side of it. A woman in a suit sat at the opposite end of the table. Two dwarves with open laptops occupied the seats to her left. She stood to greet them.
Bartholomew, she shook Bart's hand. It's been a long time. So long that I wasn't sure you'd remember me.
This must be Fran Berryman, the remarkable young woman everybody has been telling me so much about.
Dooley looked down at Fran's roller skates. My, you're even wearing those away from the cameras.
Oh, totally. It's important to display a consistent image.
Fran shook Elizabeth's hand. It's great to meet you. This place is, like, totally cool.
But in an ordinary business way. Nothing weird, just really awesome and, oh yeah, this is Elithan Tannerin, our director of public relations.
I imagine that's a challenging role at a firm like yours.
Oh yeah, totally. Elithan has to—
Not at all, Elithan said. You'd be amazed at how smoothly Fran has Mana Wave running.
Your director of software development was arrested by the Silver Griffins while running naked down the street.
An unfortunate misunderstanding, and a reflection of the passion that we at Mana Wave Industries bring to everything we do.
Dooley chuckled. Not the worst pitch I've ever heard. Speaking of which, the floor is yours.
She sat and watched them expectantly. Bart took a laptop from his briefcase and plugged it into a data cable that snaked out of the table. An image appeared on one of the blank screens, a slide reading Mana Wave Industries with their temporary logo in one corner. Fran suddenly remembered the big load of notes Bart had sent her to prepare for this meeting that she'd almost entirely failed to read. She was sure it would be fine. After all, this was her company. No one knew it better than she did.
Okay, so this is us.
Fran smiled. She'd insisted on the next slide, a picture of their small team in their basement office, smiling and waving at the camera. It was a picture that helped her to relax and put a human face on the company. Or, more accurately, a magical face.
Mana Wave Industries is a new company developing magical solutions for the modern age. Our approach brings together the best of Earth technology and Oriceran magic to develop outside-the-box answers for problems people didn't realize they had, for a dazzling synergy of the best of two worlds. She was particularly proud of wielding the word synergy, which she'd learned from Gruffbar. She felt it gave the presentation a professional feel. This is our central product. She motioned, and Bart moved them to the next slide, which showed a gray box with crystals along the top and wires dangling from one side.
It doesn't look like much, but the Mana Wave Deluxe battery is the future of power sources. It stores electricity and magical power, combining them to provide a superior energy flow for any magical technology. By integrating it into our other devices, we intend to grab the attention of a wide range of market sectors while demonstrating the efficacy of our design. It was all coming back to her now. Why had she ever worried? She knew the presentation back to front.
How does it work?
One of Dooley's dwarves asked without looking up from his screen.
Oh, that's the cool part.
Fran rolled over to one end of the screen and pointed at one of the battery's crystals.
This here is like a whole new sort of—
Elithan coughed. The sound was small, yet still sharp enough to bring Fran up short. Then she remembered the practice run they'd done to prepare her for moments like this.
That's proprietary information.
She leaned into proprietary, another of those grand words that made her sound all businesslike.
Obviously, in the interests of our investors, we can't reveal details of our intellectual property at this time.
Dooley nodded. It was a small nod, but one that made Fran feel she must be on the right track.
We have one contract already for a piece of technology powered by this battery, which we'll be delivering to the—
She caught Elithin's expression before the elf needed to clear her throat.
The people we totally can't talk about, because I agreed to a, like, really thorough non-disclosure agreement. But that contract is legit and real, honestly. Once we deliver, we'll be able to talk about it and show people what we made. And you're going to be so impressed.
I'll be the judge of what impresses me, Dooley said sternly.
Oh, yes, sorry. I didn't mean to—
Fran's voice trailed off. She was losing this. She skated from side to side, trying to gather her thoughts, but it was hard with these smartly dressed people staring at her in this intimidating boardroom. Now a giant ant was crawling past the window, and she knew she shouldn't talk about that, but she really, really, really wanted to ask how they trained them. And now that was all she could think about, and—
Bart, you tell them about the finances.
Fran hurriedly took a seat.
Okay.
Bart skipped a bunch of slides until he reached the financial graphs, then started talking about buy-in, overheads, and return on investment. That got the attention of the second dwarf, who stared at the slides intently, while Fran sat drawing deep breaths and trying to remember what she had to say next. There was something about the flexibility that came with a small operation in its early stages, about lean processes and agile working practices and—
Thank you, Bartholomew, Dooley said as Bart shifted from one slide to the next. I think I've seen enough.
Fran glanced at the others. If Dooley had seen enough, that was a good thing, right? It meant that she'd heard enough to persuade her. Elithin was as smilingly calm as ever, but the look on Bart's face said that this wasn't what they'd wanted. Fran huddled forward in her chair.
First, I want to say thank you for coming here today, Dooley said. It's always a pleasure to hear about up-and-coming businesses, and yours is certainly interesting. For my fund to invest, interesting isn't enough. I need to be sure that you have the stability, the solidity, and the firm leadership to navigate the difficult waters of establishing yourselves. What I see from you here has potential, but people with potential come to me for money every day, and potential isn't enough. I'm sorry to say that what you're offering doesn't fit the Dooley Holdings investment strategy.
She gave a small nod, and one of the dwarves got out of his seat.
Deary will see you out.
Bart disconnected his computer and put it back into his briefcase. Trying hard not to let his dejection show, he followed the dwarf out of the room, with Elithin not far behind and Fran bringing up the rear.
Ms. Berryman, Dooley called as Fran reached the doorway.
Fran turned hopefully. Had Dooley changed her mind?
Magical pheromones, Dooley said. I can't tell you the details, but we use magical pheromones to train the insects. I saw you watching the ant through the window, and it struck me that you're the sort of person who would want to know.
Fran smiled. It was something, at least, and she appreciated the act of kindness. Thank you.
You really do have potential, but you're going to need to treat this whole business more seriously if you want to succeed. Take my advice. Leave the roller skates at the door next time, and the sparkly t-shirt with them.
Thank you.
Fran turned and skated off down the corridor.
Chapter 4. After the disappointment of the meeting with Dooley, Bart decided to splurge on a taxi to carry the three of them back to Manawave Industries headquarters. They ended up catching a flying cab and rode in a basket hanging from a griffin's claws, which deposited them outside the front door of the Worn Threads carpet store. All sorts of magical creatures were adapting to the modern business environment of Mana Valley, and that included flying creatures doing deliveries and transport.
As she walked into Worn Threads, Fran waved to Raulo and Gale standing behind the counter and made her way to the door at the back. She didn't know where other startups found their homes, but she thought Mana Wave was probably the only one where another business sold carpets upstairs. Except maybe if there was a carpet startup, but she couldn't work out what that would be for. Cleaning, maybe? Through the door and down the stairs, she emerged into the large basement. It was a lot less dusty than it had been a few days before, with fewer spiderwebs hanging everywhere. The old mirror-making machine still lined the back, and the dust sheet covering a gigantic display mirror filled one wall. The team from Mana Wave Industries had set up two distinct working areas within the basement. In one corner was the office, a set of desks where Bart, Elithin, and the dwarf lawyer Gruffbar could do their work. In another corner was the workshop, with prototypes lying out on the workbenches, tools lined up neatly on a table to one side, and crates of components next to that. It also contained computers used for coding and design work. This was Singar's and Smokey's realm, home to the creative side of the business, where they made the technology. Fran had space on both sides of the room, so she could alternate her work as CEO with helping to design and create their magical technology. Although the office was closer to the stairs, today she skated straight past it to get to the workshop. After the frustration and failure of seeking investment, she needed to do something practical, something that would make her feel like she could get things right. Smokey was at his computer, analyzing the data from the encounter with the source. He was currently a cat. Fran couldn't help thinking that it would be easier to type if he shifted into his other form, that of a particularly hairy dwarf. He claimed he found it easier to think while in feline form. The CEO on roller skates wasn't going to argue with anybody else's whims. Across from him, Singar was working on the components for their prototype containment unit. So many of their hopes rested on the technology. She wasn't alone.
"Hi, Winslow," Fran said brightly. "And Enfield? What are you guys doing here?"
"Helping Ms. Twitchtail with her work," Winslow said. "We have more experience with the source than any other magicals do, so we can provide invaluable insights and ensure that you quickly and effectively complete the unit."
"Helping? Right," Singar muttered. "They're fiddling with things they don't understand."
She smacked Enfield's hand away from the rune-etched mirror at the base of the device.
"Seriously, touch it again, and I'll get you with the soldering iron."
"This is ridiculous," Enfield said. "We have a higher cause, and we need your device to fulfill it. We're only trying to help."
He crossed his arms, and the muscles under his tight t-shirt shifted. As Evermores went, he was the most pleasing to look at. Fran wouldn't have objected if he wanted to stand around the office flexing his abs. It was when he tried to flex his authority that the problems came.
"It's great that you guys want to help, but this is our business. It's our prototype, and you need to let us get on with our work," Fran reminded them.
"Exactly."
Singar glared at the Evermores.
"Keep your hands to yourselves."
Fran examined the prototype. Its fundamentals hadn't changed much from the last time they'd used it. The mirror at the bottom had runes etched along its edges. Above that was a collapsible framework of metal rods, painted black, with crystals and electronics dangling off their joints. The battery pack, which used the technology she'd so proudly showed to Dooley, was wired onto one edge of the mirror.
"Is it working yet?" she asked. "Not yet."
Singar took an etching tool from her toolkit and started fixing one of the runes, where the glass had melted and reformed under the pressure of magical power.
"The strain of capturing those goons put more pressure on the system than we thought. I don't want to run a live test until we've got it running at least as efficiently as before."
"More efficiently," Smokey interjected. "Looking at this data, We need 10 times the containment field we had last time around.
That shouldn't be a problem. Fran detached the battery unit to look inside. It's working on feedback, remember. The stronger the magical inside, the stronger the containment field.
Sure, and that's great in theory. It only works if the hardware can support that level of magic.
Which is where things went wrong before. Singar moved on to the next rune.
Your battery and feedback loop gave us enough power to hold them all, but the framework couldn't take it.
Oh, I hadn't thought about that. Fran peered at the layers of magical and technological materials in the battery pack. How about if we set an upper limit on the feedback?
Then we couldn't hold this monster you're so excited about.
Smokey tapped his screen, where her video of the source was showing next to data from magical sensors.
It's insane. Where did you find it?
He looked at the Evermores. Enfield watched Winslow from the corner of his eye, deferring to his superior's 26,000 years of experience.
The source has been with us for generations, Winslow said. It was safely contained and can be contained again once we get it back to its holding place. The difficulty is getting it there, a challenge that I'm confident you young people can meet. It's been with us for generations, doesn't answer my question. I thought your interest was in the future, not the past. Knowing where this comes from will help me understand how it works. We can't do our job when we don't have the full information, and when I do a job, I always do the best. That's an admirable attitude.
Hey, guys, I have an idea. Fran looked up, grinning. What if we replace the rods with a magical alloy? Some dwarf forges are producing amazing things now with enchantments mixed into the metal.
We've tried toughening up the frame, remember?
Singar shook her head. Then, not a tougher alloy, but one that will transfer the power more quickly.
Won't that add to the strain?
No.
Smokey jumped from his stool onto the workbench, landing smoothly on all four paws to examine the parts more closely.
If the power flows more quickly, we reduce buildups, which will alleviate the pressure, in theory at least.
The three of them fell to talking enthusiastically about the technicalities of metals and magic, bouncing ideas back and forth.
You see, Winslow said during a break in the breathless chatter, this is why I have faith in you to deliver the containment unit for us. Not for you.
Gruffbar had come over to see what all the talk was about. Now he looked up at the Evermores.
We have a contractual obligation to make the prototype for the FBI. Once that's done, we can make something for you. Master Steel Strike. I understand that you have concerns about the finances and reputation of your company, but trust me, providing us with what we need won't do you any harm. Absolutely. Once we've fulfilled our contract.
Winslow's placid smile stiffened.
Perhaps you don't appreciate what's at stake here. This is the source. A creature of vast, chaotic power. For the safety of the whole world, we need to contain it.
Gruffbar snorted.
Everyone thinks their problem is the biggest in the world. But right now, our problem is staying afloat. And that means fulfilling our contracts. Contracts are such small things in the span of centuries. We shouldn't let them hold us back. Lives are small things in the span of centuries. I've seen them lost over a packet of chips and a few poorly chosen words, but they still matter. I'm not quite sure what your point is, but reminding me how much bigger the world is won't impress me. Things that seem small to you matter to the rest of us. Things like Fran's dreams for this business.
At the mention of her name, Fran looked up from a pile of components. What's the matter, guys? She asked.
Your colleague is in some denial about the situation here, Winslow said. There are bigger things at stake than some matter of business, no matter who it's with. Prophecy tells us that letting the source run free will lead to disaster, and we must do everything we can to stop it. That means we need your trap. Prophecy. Gruffbar snorted. I'm a lawyer, not a seer. But I'll tell you this much for prophecy. It's baloney. Excuse me? Prophecies are cryptic and ambiguous, every one of them open to interpretation. Even if you had the most solid prophecy in the world, different people would still use it in different ways to justify what they want to do. That's how prophecies get used, as an excuse for every side to do what it wants to do already. Want to save the world? Prophecy told me how. Want to conquer it? Prophecy guided me to triumph. As reasons go, that's no better than because I wanted to. Prophecies sound impressive, and they're a great excuse to do what you want. They don't impress me. I have free will, and I intend to use it, not to have my fate dictated by somebody who died centuries ago.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.